Ladies and gentlemen, we are here in celebration of George Alexander Reid. Notice I use the word in celebration. When I go to funerals and Thanksgiving services, I always say that we are here to celebrate a life. Someone who came into our lives and as a result, we were blessed. Amen? And God would have loaned George to us. And by my calculation, for 73 years. Now, that's longer than most people get. So we give God thanks for the life of George Alexander Reid. The word declares that we come into this world naked, and we shall leave this world naked, because we brought nothing into this world, and indeed we can bring nothing from it. So the psalmist David said, Lord, teach me to number my days and apply my heart unto understanding. I ask at this time that we stand as we go to the opening hymn, How Great Thou Art. And my brothers and sisters, I'm going to invite Sister Joan McCormack, who will also be our moderator for this morning's proceedings, to come and lead us into that hymn, after which I will return for the opening prayer. Sister Joan.
Good morning, everyone. Bless the Lord. We are happy to be here this morning, even though it's not a happy occasion, but we celebrate the life of this noble gentleman, George Alexander Reid. At this time, we're going to do the opening hymn, How Great Thou Art. Oh, Lord, my God, when I know some wonder things my From lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then unsings my soul, my Savior God, to that God, His Son, not sparing, sent Him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on the cross, my birth. A great God. Hallelujah. At this time, I'm going to invite our pastor to come back as he will be doing the opening prayer. Let us all remain standing in the presence of the Lord.
Hallelujah. Then sings my soul, my Savior, God to thee. Father, we thank you that even in the midst of sorrow, there is hope. Even in the midst of tears, God, there is joy. And Father, we thank you that at all times and in every way, we can lean and depend on you for your grace and your mercy. Father, even as we gather today, in a sense, a very sober sense, Almighty God, I pray that your Spirit will be with us. Father, as we pay tribute, as we give our selection, as we remember, Lord God, and as we eulogize, I pray that you will come by here in a very special way. I pray for the family, that Almighty God, your strength will be given to them now, and that your Spirit of comfort will be felt in a very special way. Take control of everything that happens here, Almighty God, and let everything be done in order to your glory and to your name. And I pray that you inspire us, even Almighty God, as we grieve. And I pray that you will cause your presence to be so felt that when we leave here, our hearts would have been encouraged, and we will leave with a smile in our hearts. Father, take control now, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Bless the Lord. Remain standing as we'll be taking the scripture at this time. I'm going to be asking Sister Natalie Humphrey to come as she'll be reading from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 through to 15. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Natalie Humphrey, and I'm here to give you the scripture lessons taken from Ecclesiastes 3, from 1 to 15. There is a time for every and every season activities under the heavens. A time to born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to uproot. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to tear down and a time to build. A time to reap and a time to laugh. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to moan and a time to dance. A time to scatter stones and a time to gather them. A time to embrace and a time to refrain and embracing. A time to search and a time to give up. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to mend. A time to be silent and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time for war and a time for peace. What do workers gain from their toil? I have seen the burden God has laid on human race. He has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in human heart. Yet no one can fathom what God has done from the beginning to the end. I know that there is nothing better for people than to be happy and to do good while they are alive, that each of them may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all their toil. This is a gift of God. I know everything God has done will endure forever. Nothing can be added and nothing can take it away from it. God does it so that people will fear him. 15th and last, whatever has already been and what will be has been before. And God will call the past. And God will call the past to account ear and get a portion of God's words, we honor it by saying amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Sister Natalie, for reading the scripture. At this time, we'll be doing a tribute, and it will be coming to us from Kishane Brown. Is Kishane here?
Your nights of confusion has been too long. Your ship has lost anchor, and the storms got you drifting. Just hold on to Jesus. Your storm, Sister Reid and family. It may seem like you're alone, but know that the Lord is with you. Thank you very much, Kishane Brown, for such a lovely tribute. Ride out your storms. The storm will always pass, but there is an eye in every storm. It doesn't matter what category storm, there is always an eye. And if you just hold on until the eye passes, then we know that there is peace in the midst of the storm. God bless you. At this time, we'll be taking a selection from the Reid family, so you can come at this time.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. The news came to Jesus, please come fast. Lazarus is sick, and without your help, he will not last. Mary and Martha, watch their brother died. They waited for Jesus. He did not come, and they wondered why. The death watch was over, buried 4 days. Somebody said, he'll soon be here, the Lord's on his way. Martha ran to him, and then she cried, Lord, if you have been here, you could have still be alive, but you're 4 days late, and all hope is gone. Lord, we don't understand why you waited so long, but he said, Martha, show me the grave. But she said, Lord, you don't understand. He's been there 4 days. The gravestone was rolled back. Then Jesus cried, Lazarus, come forth. Then somebody said, he's alive, he's alive. You may be fighting a battle of fear. You've cried to the Lord, I need you now, but he has not appeared. Friends, don't be discouraged, 'cause he is still the same. He'll soon be here, he rolled back the stone and call out your name. Lord, we don't understand.
even though he was 4 days late in this particular situation with Lazarus, he was still on time. So I just want to encourage you all to know that God is an on-time God. You may be wondering why. A lot of questions that will not be answered. But God is an on-time God, and he knows all things. So I just want to encourage you all. Thank you so much, bereaved family, for such a lovely item. Bless the Lord. As we continue with the program, we'll be doing the offering at this time. And we'll be doing this hymn, Precious Memories. So I'm going to be asking Sister Ferris to direct the persons as they come from the back. So just follow the instruction of the usher as she will direct you to come and give your offering. So we have two baskets, one on this side and one on this side.
Precious memories, unseen angels sent from somewhere to my soul. How they linger ever near me, and the sacred past unfold. Precious
Reid, but I believe that those memories will help you to be encouraged. So I encourage you this morning, just remember the golden memories, and that will give you peace. Amen. At this time, I'm going to be inviting our pastor, Reverend Wisdom, to come as he will. Sorry, I'm going to bless the offering, and afterwards, our pastor, will be coming as he will be doing the word. Hallelujah. Let us stand as we bless the offering. Our Father and our God, we just want to give you thanks for this day. Lord, you said in everything we must be thankful. And so, Lord, even in this occasion, we are giving you thanks. And at this time, Lord, your people have brought an offering, God Almighty, to the house, the storehouse. We ask, God Almighty, that you will bless it even now in the mighty name of Jesus. We ask, Father God, for even a blessing for those who stretch forth to give this morning. And I pray, God Almighty, that you continue to, oh God Almighty, allow their store baskets to continue to remain full in the mighty name of Jesus. Bless this offering, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Remain standing as our pastor will be coming to us with the word. God bless you.
Hallelujah. You may be seated, my brothers and sisters. Let me greet you again in the name of Jesus. Welcome those who are joining us online as well. I am noticing that the house is getting rather full, and the protocol is that if the body is inside, there can only be 20 persons inside. So could I ask that, no, I'm not asking you to leave. I'm asking that the parlor, that was the arrangement, that the body goes back into the hearse, or at least on the patio outside, so we can be on the safe side of the law, amen? So could we get the persons from the funeral home? While they are doing that, my brothers and sisters, I greet you, for those who were not here when I greeted at first. The time we are living in is a serious time. Amen? And I don't preach to the dead, because they can't hear me. Amen? Are we here? I don't preach to the dead. I preach to the living. Amen, church? Amen. I don't want to feel like I'm preaching to the dead, you know. Amen, church? Praise the Lord, the living are here. And I have a word to share with you quickly. I went to a funeral some years ago, before COVID, and the preacher preached for 3 hours and about 45 minutes. And I wrote a note to myself. Self, keep it short. I must have written that over 100 times as I sat through that message. So I promise you, if you preach with me, the more you preach with me, the shorter I'll be. And I promise you that I will not preach for more than 3 hours. Okay? About 3 hours, but no more than 3 hours. Is that all right? That don't sound all right. I want to share a word quickly with you from the book of Matthew, chapter 25. And I'll be reading from verse 4 to the point, 14, sorry, to the appointed verse. For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country, who called his servants and delivered unto them his goods. And unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to another, to each man according to his several ability, and straightway took his journey. Then he that received the 5 talents went and traded with the same and made them other 5 talents. And likewise he that received 2, he also gained 2. But he that received one went and dig in the earth and hid his Lord's money. After a long time, the Lord of those servants came and reckoned with them, so that he that had received 5 talents came and brought other 5 talents, saying, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 5 talents. Behold, I have gained 5 beside the 5 talents that you gave me. His master said unto him, well done, you good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of the Lord. Also, he that received 2 talents came and said, Lord, you gave unto me 2 talents. I have gained 2 other talents besides them. His Lord said unto him, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of the Lord. Then he that had received the 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew that you are a hard man, reaping where you did not sow, and gathering where you did not straw. And I was afraid and went and hid your money in the earth. Lo, there you have what is yours. His Lord said unto him, you wicked and slothful servant, you know that I reap what I sow not, and gather where I have not strawn. You ought therefore to have put my money in the exchangers, and then my coming I should have received my own with usury. Take therefore the talent from him and give it unto him that has 10 talents. For everyone that has been given, for everyone that hath shall be given, and he that and shall have abundance, but he from him that has not shall be taken away even that which he has. And cast the unprofitable servant into outer darkness, there shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory. And behold, he shall gather the nations, and he shall separate them one from another, as shepherd divide his sheep from the goats. Father, we thank you for your word. Bless your word unto our hearts even now, and glorify your name. In Jesus' name, amen. My brothers and sisters, I want to talk about the reckoning. Can you say with me, the reckoning? Can you say with me, the reckoning? Hallelujah. My brothers and sisters, as we look into this word, I want to talk about a few things before we close. The first thing I want us to realize is that every man has been allotted within himself certain gifts. Are you with me? Now I want you to notice that Jesus, when he was saying this parable, he was telling what the kingdom of God is like. And I want to say to each and every one of us that God has placed in all of us some giftings that are valuable for his kingdom. Are we still here? There are some things that are inside you that nobody else will have. And there are things that you can do that nobody else on earth can do it. Are you with me? So I see my photographer over here is taking photographs. When he takes a photograph and somebody else takes the same camera and takes a photograph, even standing in the same place, it's going to come out different, because what is inside him is going to be different than what is inside somebody. We all have something to offer this world that nobody else has. So I want to say to us that each and every one of us today is special, is valuable in this earth. And on this earth, we have a short time to make an impact, a lasting impact on the life of others. So there's an allotment that comes from God Himself that has been implanted in every single one of us, and it is unique, even as we are unique. My brothers and sisters, I am of a family of 9 brothers, and they mistake us for each other all the time. But when we look in the mirror, we can see that we are different. Throughout all of Jamaica, there are 3 point something million people, and all of them look different. There are billions of people in the world, and we all look different. We all have differences. God has implanted in you, sitting in this room, something that is valuable in the kingdom of God. And I want to say to you, my brothers and sisters, that each and every one of us are servants of the Almighty God. And whether we choose to serve Him, yes or no, we are still servants of the Almighty God. Hello? And what it means is that which we have does not belong to us. It belongs to the Almighty God. Every breath that we take belongs to our Almighty Creator. And everything that we can do and everything that we can learn comes from what He has placed inside of us. Are you still with me, church? There is an allotment, and the fact that there is a master means that we are servants. I want to tell somebody that we are not servants to any man. We cannot be servants or slaves to any man, because we are made servants to the Almighty God, and He is the only one that we are called to reckon with. He's the only one that we are called to be accountable to. Can I talk to the church of God? So it doesn't matter what man says about you. What matters is what God has placed inside of you, my brothers and sisters, and what you do with what God has placed inside of you. So there is an allotment, but there is also an assignment. Can I talk to the church of God? My brothers and sisters, as we look, we see that some got 5 talents, one got 2, and the other got 1. The one that got 5 said, you know something, I am not going to second with having the same 5 that my master give me. And when my master comes back, then I can only give him 5. No, he said, you know, I'm going to go and I'm going to make a do with what he has given me, so that when he comes back, I can march up to him with my head held high, and I can present him more than he gave me. You know the worst thing that we can do in this life? Nothing. There is so much potential inside of us. Hello? There are so many giftings and talents inside of us, but we must work on those giftings and those talents to make them shine. Can I talk to the church of the Almighty God? There are some scholars. There are some philosophers. There are some skilled men. There are some mechanics. There are some engineers. There are some persons who can come up with ideas, but they sit down and do nothing. The one with 5 said, you know what? I must grow. I must expand. I must improve. And not only must I improve, but I must do it in service to the Almighty God. I can ask the question, how has your gifting, how has your talent been used for the purpose of the kingdom of the Almighty God? Because you know something, we're going to use it, you know, but are we using it in service to God? Because a lot of times we use it in service and people use us, not true? Talk to me now. Not true? Or we do some things and we don't get the right pay. In fact, the person who get the most pay seems to do the least work. Hello? and the person who do the hard work get the more, get the least pay. Hello, and don't even get the recognition for their jobs. But when you are serving God, it does not work that way. The person got to say, you know something, I got me too. It simply means that you know, I can manage these two. I don't want the five that he has because I can't manage the five. Can I talk to the church of God? Sometimes we look at some people and we envy them, but we don't realize we can't manage what they have. Can I talk to the church? In fact, they can't manage what we have. We just don't know what we have. Oh, praise the Lord. And as the one with the two went out, he invested himself and he earned two more. He earned 100%. I want to tell somebody that in life, you must be serving in a place where God can be pleased with you. In life, you must be living in such a way that you are benefiting the kingdom of God and you are being a witness to the kingdom of God. The one who got one say, you know something? Laziness. We can't bother. There are some young people in here who from COVID, maybe not you, from COVID come. Me can't bother. Online learning, me can't bother. Amen. And they don't show up for class even though they have internet and device. There are some persons who can't bother to work. There are some persons who can't bother to come to church. There are some persons who can't bother to live for the Lord. It is too hard. But when you invest yourself, you reap a reward. And watch this. There not only is there an assignment and an allotment, but there is an accountability. There is a time coming where you must answer for everything that God gives you. God is not going to ask you for what he did not give you. God is going to say, what did you do with what I gave you? And watch this, it says, it's appointed unto man what? Wants to die, but after is the judgment. You know what judgment is? Simply standing before God, and God is going to say, what did you do with your life? There are two men that I think about. There's one called Lazarus. And the other one is the rich man. I don't know why they call him Dives because I don't see it in the Bible. But let's call him Dives. Dives was rich. He had everything in this world that you could ever imagine. If it was Dives' funeral we're keeping today, Sister Reid, vehicle line on, gone way down, sir. Because Dives was a rich man. He had everything to his comfort. He had friends, family, food, house, big. And he could splurge and palave all he wanted. And then there was Lazarus. Lazarus was a poor man to the point where he was desiring some of Dives' food. But Dives said, no, only the dog get the leftover. He did not consider Lazarus equal to his dog. You know, there are some people in life who are like that, who look down on people because they believe that what they have is better than what you have. Well, here's the problem. Lazarus died, and Dives also died. The rich died, and the poor died. The educated died, and the uneducated died. The pastor died, and the barkeeper died. Hello? The gunman died, and the Bible man die. Can I talk to somebody in here? The young die and the old die. We all die. One thing that is certain, apart from taxes, is death. Hello, somebody. So the pretty die, and the not so pretty die. The slim die and the fat die. No matter how much we work out and get buff, death is the equalizer for everybody. And when somebody go on like they are better than me, I say we're going to share the same fate. Hello, you are going to die and I'm going to die. We just don't know when or how. Can I talk to the church? 5 more minutes and I'm out of here. But the thing that matters is what happens after death. Because after death, some people say, that's it. I live, I die, and I'm gone. Well, good for you. But can I tell you, something happens after death called the judgment. And I could go into proof and evidence of persons who have died and come back to life. They went to a place that was real. And they had experiences after death. But somehow or the other, God sent them back and says, not your time yet. Hello? And I know a couple of those persons. Can I talk to the church of God? After death, there's an event called judgment. And watch the judgment. The master came back. The owner of the servants came back. The owner of your life is going to come back. And after death, you have to stand in front of him. And he's going to ask you to give an account for what you have done with your life. So the one with 5 walked up and said, Master, I have served in your kingdom. And here is 5 more. I have found the ministry. I found my mission. And I worked on my mission. And now I have accomplished these things. And his work was examined. And the master said, yes, I left you with 5. And now you are returning 10 to me. If we go to the other passage that deal with it, he said, come into the kingdom. And not only am I going to make you a part of the kingdom, I'm going to make you a ruler. And you're going to rule over 10 cities. Go rule. The one with 2 comes in and he said, Master, you gave me 2. And here's another 2. The master said, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of the Lord. The one with 1 came and he said, Master, you are a wicked man. You're an unreasonable man. You want what you did not sow, and you want what you never worked for. That's how some of us treat God. We say, God, this is my life, and you want me to live it your way, but I have to live it my way. God said, it is okay. Go and live it your way, but remember that you have to give an account at the end of the day. Sister, read, your salvation can't save your children or your grandchildren. It only gives them an example to follow. Can I talk to the church? Hello, Pastor, salvation cannot save you. You have to give an account. And you're going to hear 1 of 2 statements. Well done, enter. Our wicked, slothful, leave, depart. And he looked on the one and said, all you needed to do, since you were so lazy, is to carry the money to the bank. And he go and get what? Interest. And at least I would get back what is mine with a little bit of interest. You know what is the bank when it comes to the kingdom of God is the church. All you have to do, I just join church. Give your life to the Lord. And sit down in the kingdom. and you will grow. Can I tell somebody, you cannot join the kingdom and don't grow. From you join the kingdom, something is going to happen to you, and spiritual growth is going to take place. Lazarus heard, enter the kingdom after a miserable life, but Lazarus was living a kingdom life. Dives had everything, money, wealth, friends, but at the end of the day, he heard, depart. It is not how much you earn. It is not how educated you are. It is not what status you are in life. You know what car or van or plane you drive or fly. It is answering the call to the Lord and say, you know, Lord, all to Jesus I surrender. My brothers and sisters, every time I come to a funeral, I say to the people, one of these days, somebody's going to be preaching over me. And the only thing that I hope is that my soul is right with God. I want to ask you a question. Is your soul right with God? Are you investing in the kingdom of God? I'm not talking about giving a little offering. That's not investing. I'm talking about your soul. Have you invested your soul in the kingdom of God? I say, God, take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to you. Lord, use me. Lord, save me. Lord, make me the kind of person you want me to be. I want to challenge you on behalf of George Alexander Reid to make it right with God. Hallelujah. Because I him I preach this message on me, you know, because you would not be here if it wasn't for him. So on behalf of George Alexander Reid, I'm asking you, make it right. Because God has placed value in you for his kingdom. And he's going to bring you into account when the roll is called up yonder. Hallelujah. Is there someone who will say, Lord, I'm willing to invest my life into your kingdom? I want you to stand right where you are. Sister Pearson will be coming to pray for the family, but I want to pray for somebody who said, today I want to invest my life in the kingdom. Stand up. Don't be afraid to stand up if you want to invest your life in the kingdom. If you want to hear, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of the Lord. Stand right where you are. Don't look on anybody, because guess what? Ain't nobody going to be standing beside you when you face the king. I invite you to stand and say, Lord, I surrender to you. Is there even one person today who will say, Lord, I invest my life into your kingdom? I ask one more time. Take the chance and the time to say, yes, Lord. Hallelujah. God bless you as I turn back over to our moderator.
Hallelujah. Indeed, we must say thanks, Rev, for such a powerful word. We must know that it is our duty to invest in the kingdom of God. Amen. Thank you, sir. At this time, we'll be taking the eulogy, and this will be done by Orit Ellis, and afterwards, we'll be doing the prayer for the family by Sister Ferris Spears.
Good afternoon, church. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Yes, my name is Orit Ellis, grandson to Mr. George Reid. His full name is George Alexander Reid. I'm here just to give you a short reminder of who Mr. George was. Mr. George Reid, who was born on the 1949 September, the sixth. Mr. George Reid was also a granddad to my grandmother's grandchildren, me, Philip, and Dean, and Denisha, and also our other family member. He was also a father to us. His passing left us grieving, so sad, and we are now hoping for the best as we continue with our life. He has left his son, which is, where is he? Roy Reid? Yes, he's outside here, yeah. Just to let you know, he had five children, which fourth was are now deceased, leaving one, Roy Reid. And, you know, I mean, there's not much we can show to, you know, express our feelings, but I mean, we really miss Mr. George, right? Yes. He was also a worker for the Water Commission for several years, where he had committed serving, and in the community where we live, he was also another man who helped us to get water in our houses, or at home, right? Later on, he was also a shopkeeper, where he spent some time doing all of that. He was such a humble man, a very quiet one. Most of the time, you would find him maybe laughing or being jovial was when he had a little drink. And then you would get to, you know, have some fun with him. I remember times while at home when he would come home after work and he would take us candy, peanut, and yes, we would feel loved by him, right? So Mr. George will be sadly missed by the friends and family, and also everyone who knows him very well, right? His passing, leaving us, right, was not something we expected. But we all have to understand that life and death is a must. And it's a thing that we will have to face. We will have to face it. So to my family and who is grieving, please hang on. We're gonna get by, right? Mr. George, I'm so sorry that, you know, I didn't get the chance to, you know, because after the sickness he had, he was deteriorating, like, you know, I mean, he didn't understand much of what we were saying to him, right? But yes, there were times, even at nights, he would wake up and I would come home late and I would be in the house, you know, talking with him. But he understands, even during the time while he was about to pass away, I was there with him and he acknowledged my love, right? I'm so sorry I didn't get to, you know, even have a word with him or so on to show him how much we really honored his time and being a part of our family, and also making or doing as much to carry us on. But yes, Mr. George, I miss you so much, sir. And I really, really want to tell you that I love you, and journey well. Rest in peace. Amen.
Amen, amen. Thank you, Orit, for the eulogy. And at this time, Sister Ferris will be coming with the prayer. So I'm going to ask all the family members to stand at this time. All
all family members, can you please, bereaved family members, could you please stand where you are as we'll be doing the prayer.
Hallelujah. Let us pray. Eternal, loving Father, as we gathered here in your presence, Lord, we want to give you thanks and we want to give you praise. Father, it's not a good feeling, but God, we still give you thanks. I said in everything, we should give you thanks. We should give you praise. We must sing our praises to you in spite of. And this morning, God, I want to place the very family in your hands. As the young lady sing, hold on to Jesus. He's right there with you, Sister Reid. He's your comforter when you need him. When you need a friend, call upon the name of Jesus. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Hallelujah. He is your best friend. Hallelujah. He will be your guide. Hallelujah. Father, I pray, Lord Jesus, that you will wrap your loving arms around this family at this time, oh God. Let them know, God, that you'll never leave them nor forsake them. You will be their comforter and their friend in this time of their loss. Father God, lead and direct them in a special way, Lord. And Lord, as I place them comprehensively in your hands this morning and ask, oh God, that you will continue to be with them. You will continue, oh God, to provide for them, oh God Almighty. Let their store basket will never go empty, Lord God. I pray, Lord Jesus, that they continue to be with you, oh God Almighty, despite of all that is happening around them. Help them, oh God, to look up, oh God, because you will never leave them nor forsake them in this time. As I give you all the honor and I give you all the glory through your son's name. Amen and amen.
Amen and amen. Thank you so much, Sister Ferris. So I just want to say thanks to everyone who have participated this morning. And as we are here, we are at the end. We're going to do the closing hymn. Is there any announcements? The body will be laid to rest by the Della Penna's funeral home. So that will be at, what's the address again? It will be the Hillview, sorry about that. Interment follows at the Hillview Memorial Gardens, Moor Park, St. James. So as we leave, we go straight there, right? All right, so I'm going to ask you all to stand as we will be doing the closing hymn.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, with my soul, it is well, it is well, it is well with my soul, my sin, oh, the joy of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul. It is well with my soul, with my soul. It is well, it is well, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul, with my soul. It is well, it is well, it is well with my soul.
God bless you. Stand for the benediction. Now by the saving grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, the faithful fellowship of the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, rest, remain, and abide with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you all for coming. God bless you.
How do I say goodbye to what we had? The good time that made us laugh, I'll wait them back. I thought we'd get forever's gone away. It's so hard to say goodbye to yesterday.
I don't know where the road is going to. All I know is where we've been and what we've been through. Ooh. If we get to see tomorrow, I hope it's worth all the wait. It's so say goodbye to yesterday.
And I'll take with me the memories to be my sunshine after the rain. It's so hard to say goodbye today.
Hold it. Hallelujah. Meet me by the river someday. Meet me by the river, not far away. For when my Lord shall call me home, happy, happy home beyond the sky. Meet me by the river someday. Meet me by the river someday. Meet me by the river, not far away. When my Lord shall call me home, happy, happy home beyond the sky. Meet me by the river someday. Meet me by the river someday. Meet me by the river, not far away. When my Lord shall call me home, happy, happy home beyond the sky. Meet me by the river someday. I know where I am going, I know. I know where I am going, I know, yes, I know. For doorbells are ringing, happy children are singing. I know where I am going, I know. I know where I am going, I know. I caught up to meet him in the air. I shall be caught up to meet him, caught up to greet him. Joy and happiness, peace is mine till the storm. If you miss me, don't come searching. If you can't find me, you know that I'm gone. If you don't hear from me, don't come knocking at my door. I'll be gone in the twinkling of an eye. For if you miss me, don't come searching. If you don't find me, you know that I'm gone. If you don't hear from me, don't come knocking at my door. I'll be gone in the twinkling of an eye. For if you miss me, don't come searching. If you don't find me, you know that I'm gone. If you don't hear from me, don't come knocking at my door. I'll be gone in the twinkling of an eye. Oh, if you miss me, don't come searching. If you don't find me, you know that I'm gone. If you don't hear from me, don't come knocking at my door. I'll be gone in the twinkling of an eye. We shall have a grand time up in heaven. We shall have a grand time up in heaven, have a grand time. Oh, walking with the angels, singing hallelujah. We shall have a grand time up in heaven, have a grand time. Oh, we shall have a grand time up in heaven. We shall have a grand time up in heaven, have a grand time. Oh, walking with the angels, singing hallelujah. We shall have a grand time up in heaven, have a grand time. Oh, we shall have a grand time up in heaven. We shall have a grand time up in heaven, have a grand time. Oh, walking with the angels, singing hallelujah. We shall have a grand time up in heaven, have a grand time. Oh, when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we see Jesus, we will sing and shout for victory. Oh, when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. Oh, when we see Jesus, we will sing and shout for victory. Oh, when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. For when we see Jesus, we will sing and shout for victory. He's coming back again, he's coming back again. He went away not to stay, he's coming back again. He's coming back again, he's coming back again. Sing glory, hallelujah, he's coming back again. He is coming back again, he's coming back again. He went away not to stay, he's coming back again. He's coming back again, he's coming back again. Singing glory, hallelujah, he's coming back again. He's coming back again, he's coming back again. He went away not to stay, he's coming back again. He's coming back again, he's coming back again. Singing glory, hallelujah, he's coming back again.
Glory, hallelujah, he's coming back again. As we bring this time to a close, I just want to say my final word of encouragement to the family. And as we bring the curtain down, I want to encourage you that what I've found is that death has two effects on people. One, it can bring you closer together and make you realize that you really don't have as much time as you think you have. Or two, it can tear you apart and we can blame or fight among ourselves for dead left and things like that. Or or we can do the first thing and value the time that we have together with one another. I want to encourage you to value each other, value the time you have together, and ensure that you don't waste any time. Don't waste any time with malice. Don't waste any time with quarrel. Don't waste any time with any disagreements. We will have disagreements, but let us disagree, maybe cuss, and then we go back to being family. But don't let the night go down without you making it up with one another. Because the day might light and one person doesn't wake up. So let us value the time that we have. Let us at this time pronounce the benediction. I commit you to the grace of the Almighty God, who is able to keep you from falling and to preserve your soul faultless to the day of his return. The Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you and give you his peace. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Sleep on, beloved, sleep and take your rest. Lay down your head upon your Savior's breast. We love you, but Jesus loves you best. Good night, good night, good night. God bless you, everybody. God bless you. Have a good afternoon.